want to welcome you, my dear brothers and sisters, to this service today. And I hope you are keeping safe wherever you are. This is a very difficult time, as we all know. Personally, I've lost so many close friends. I've lost some workmates. I really believe this is a saddening moment for most of us. But all the same, if you really abide in the Lord will be with you always, as he promised in the scriptures. Just trust in him all the time and he will be with you. Shall we then pray? Dear Father, we want to thank you for this wonderful and Lord Jesus thrilling moment once again to be in thy presence. Father, Lord God, as we see the world panicking, Father, they do not know where to turn to. And Lord Jesus, we see so many confusing messages in the social media and Father creating panic in the entire country. But Lord Jesus, Father, we know one thing, that you are with us, as you said in the scriptures, that you will be with us even as to the consummation of the world. Father, this morning, I want to dedicate the congregation before thee, Lord Jesus. For Father, I know this is a virtual congregation, but they are all, Father, eagerly waiting for thee to speak unto them, Father. May you feed their souls, may you feed their spirits, Lord Jesus, Father. And Father, when they leave this place, may they be like those men who were on their way to Emmaus. Father, when they said, into our hearts, burn within us, as yet he spoke unto us. Father, Lord Jesus, may their hearts, Lord Jesus, burn, Lord Jesus, as you speak unto them. Father, may we see fruits, Lord Jesus, Father, emerging out of thy word, which thou planteth in their hearts, Lord Jesus. And Father, we trust thee, we glorify thy name, Lord Jesus. I take charge and control over every foul spirit in the name of our Lord Jesus. Father, we thank you all. Father, we also thank you for thy presence. For Father, you said in the scriptures that where two or three are gathered in thy name, Father, you will be in their midst. Father, we believe that you are here today, and Father, we trust in thee, and Father, we know that there is no safer place that we can run unto except you, Lord Jesus. We thank you and we glorify thy name. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we pray it. Amen and amen. Shall we turn to our Bibles, my brothers and my sisters? And today we are going to read the same scripture that we read last time when we met. And that is Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. And after that we shall move on to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 up to verse 28. But I want us to begin with Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. It reads, "And the Lord God said, it is not good that the man should be alone. I'll make him an helpmeet for him. And out of the ground, the Lord God formed every beast of the field and every fowl of the air, and brought them unto Adam to see what he would call them. And whatsoever Adam called every living creature, that was the name thereof. And Adam gave names to all cattle, to all the fowl of the air, and to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an helpmeet for him. And the Lord God caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, and he slept. And he took one of the ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof. And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman, and brought her unto the man. And Adam said, this is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh." Now let's go to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 to verse 28. And the scripture reads, "Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands as unto the Lord, for the husband is the head of the wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the savior of the body. Therefore, as the church is subject unto Christ, so let the wives be to their own husbands in everything. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies? He that loveth his wife loveth himself. May God add a blessing to the reading of the word. Amen. You can sit down. My brothers and sisters, today we continue with the same topic that we've been having. If you recall, last time we had a very interesting topic. I hope you enjoyed it. And our previous sermon was the place of love and respect in marriage. The place of love and respect in marriage. That was our previous sermon. And if you recall, we read the same scriptures, Genesis chapter 2, verse 18 to verse 24. And we didn't even stop there. We continued and read Ephesians, right? Today, our sermon will center around the same theme, right? But I have taken out two important words that I want us to think about, to reflect on, and the words that I want to emphasize. And today I've picked a word called contempt, and I've also picked a word called hostility. And I want to call this sermon contempt and hostility in marriage. Contempt and hostility in marriage. In other words, we are talking about contempt and we are talking about hostility in marriage. Now, of course, if you follow the scriptures that I've just read, you will discover that those two words do not appear in the scriptures that I've just read you. Right, they are not there. Right, but somehow, as we saw, in the Garden of Eden, man was lonely, and you know that very well, I've always said this, right? And there was a vacuum in his life, right, that needed to be filled. And although God formed every other animal and of course the trees and the oceans and the fish and the lions, right? And Adam participated in giving names to these creatures that God had created. And the Bible tells us that whatever name Adam gave, God actually confirmed it. So he did not really dispute with Adam, saying that what you've said is incorrect. No, he simply approved whatever Adam said, meaning that Adam took part in the work that God was doing in the Garden of Eden, but Adam was not very happy, right? There was a loneliness, right? There was a vacuum, there was a space, a void that needed to be filled up, right? And the animals could not fill it, the plants could not fill it, right? The oceans could not fill it, the fish could not do it, the fowls of the air could not do it, right? And that's why God in his wisdom, right, said, well, this man called Adam that I see, the only thing that can make him feel right, that is in the right place and take away that loneliness, is if I remove, right, that spirit in him, because man had two spirits, a feminine and masculine spirit, said, let me now remove a rib, right, and put a feminine spirit in that rib and return it unto Adam. Right, and that's what he did, right? So in other words, he made Adam to sleep in the Garden of Eden, and of course he removed that rib, right, and formed Eve, and brought Eve unto Adam, and Adam was very excited. We see that very well, and that's what the scripture tells us, very, very excited. So meaning that Adam was supposed to live with Eve, right, for the rest of his life, right, and as the Bible tells us, Eve was supposed to be an helpmate, right, because even when God created the animals, right, the animals could not become suitable helpmates unto Adam, right? Meaning that Adam, right, needed an helpmate, right? In other words, that particular companion that was fit for him, right, that was fit for the kind of work that Adam had been created to do, right? Because Adam was supposed to participate in a number of activities as God had actually articulated in the Garden of Eden. So we see that very well. Right. Now, that is really what happened in creation. That's what happened in the beginning, and that's what happened in Genesis. And Genesis is a seed chapter, right? And if you continue reading the scriptures, right, that's why verse 24 tells you, that's Genesis chapter 2, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Cleave, that is super glue, right? Because this rib was part of Adam. It's not really just throwing it around and leaving the rib there to suffer, but just to become one, right? Cleave unto the woman, right? And this actually, a man is commanded to leave, right? The father and mother, you leave your relatives. And sometimes I wonder, men who get into marriages, and you find that the mother, right, of the man still has control over his house. It's very, very funny, because that is contrary to the scripture. Genesis chapter 2 verse 24 says, therefore shall a man leave his father and mother and shall cleave unto his wife. Right now, if you still go back and you let the family members influence everything you are doing in your family, right, and also harass your wife, there's something fundamentally wrong there, right? And that's where some of these problems come from, right? Especially when the family members start, of course, influencing, right? And when they come in and start certainly doing things which are not required by the one of the spouses, then you get these problems. And that's why this issue of contempt and this issue of hostility comes in, right? And the Bible tells us whoever finds a good wife, of course, finds treasure. And that's why the price of that woman cannot be compared to any price of anything on this planet Earth. So we are talking about contempt, right, and hostility. And remember, in the previous sermon, we were talking about the love and respect. And that's the whole truth, right? And really, love and respect move together, as we saw, without really repeating the previous ideas that I did give you as presented in the Bible and various scriptures that are found in the Bible. So contempt and hostility is one of the issues that we see in marriage. I've just read for you Ephesians chapter 5 from verse 22, where women, right, are certainly told to respect their husbands, right? And of course, sometimes it is very, very hard to respect. And husbands are also taught to love their wives. Usually there's a problem between love and respect. Now, as I told you last time, without love, right, if the husband does not show love to the wife, she reacts without respect. And without respect, right, he reacts. Now, the husband reacts without love, right? So today, I just want to, as we continue with the contempt, right, as we saw a few minutes ago, right, and hostility, right, these are usually expressed by the husband and the wife, or husbands and wives in a marriage relationship, right? Now, usually women criticize their husbands, right? And of course, men also keep quiet most of the time, right? Now, usually, I just want to bring the hard reality, which is very, very difficult for people to believe. But when men hear criticism, right, usually criticism is interpreted by husbands as contempt, right? And women are very good at criticizing, and they are very good in terms of talking, right? They have that tongue, right? That tongue can speak anything, right? That tongue can actually bite, right? That tongue can actually act as a spear or a needle, right? Or thorns, right, in this case. And the husband can actually feel the thorns entering his body. He can actually feel the pins entering his body. And he can feel some kind of a spear getting into his body and getting into his nerves. So men usually hear criticism as contempt, while that silence that comes from a man is felt by the woman as hostility. Right. For many of you who are married and you are there in the congregation, you know very well that each one of us has an experience that may not be exactly the same as the experience of the other person, but there are those general things that we see, right? And I just want to emphasize this point here, that emphasizing aspects that relate to husbands and the aspects that relate to women, right? So let me emphasize now to women, right, or wives, that when men hear negative criticism, right, it doesn't take them long to start interpreting that as contempt. And when we talk about contempt, we are talking about disrespect, right? And therefore, you need to guard your tongue. And James is very clear about that, right? A tongue is a very small member, right, in our bodies, right? Right, a tongue, the smallest member of your body, right? But very, very horrible, right? A tongue, very, very horrible. It can set the entire forest, the entire bush on fire, right? And yet many of us do not even know how to govern, right, this thing called a tongue. And that's why, sisters and brothers, we need to appreciate the fact that the hearing aids that men wear are not the same as the hearing aids that actually women wear, right? Men interpret things differently from the way women interpret things, right? And you need to be aware of that, right? So if a man if a man hears those negative criticisms and the negative statements you are making about him, right, he really feels disrespected, right? And that's why I told you that a man really wears what we call blue hearing aids, right? So his hearing aids are blue, and they simply tell him a woman is disrespectful. And that's why when you talk to men, most of the men, right, one of the issues that they point out, right, especially about their wives, is the issue of disrespect. Men will tell you, my wife does not respect me, right? My wife is disrespectful, right? Why? Because of the statements that you make. You talk about your husband, right? In front of the children, in front of the neighbors. You talk to the bystanders. You talk to the fellows passing by the roadside. You tell every other person, right, about your husband. Because for you are very good at talking, right? And men interpret this as disrespect because they wear blue hearing aids, right? And of course, when the wife sends out those what we call pink pointed messages, I call them pink pointed messages, right? Because for you now you're using pink hearing aids, right? So you send out those messages which are pointed, right? And the husband will soon say to himself, I don't deserve this kind of talk. The husband or your husband will say, everybody around respects me except you. You are just picking a fight. You may find that your husband is an MD somewhere. Your husband is a CEO somewhere. Your husband is a preacher somewhere. He's a minister of the gospel. Your husband might be respected in many, many circles. So when he sits with men, he feels he's great because of that respect that they give him, right? And you may find that he is a general. Your husband is a general, is a major general. But when he comes at home and you start really sending those sharp pointed pink messages, he starts wondering, what's happening to this woman? Doesn't this woman know that every other person in this country respects me? Wherever I move, I'm respected. What is happening? What is the problem? Everybody respects me except you. You are just picking a fight. I wish you would just be quiet. And this is really what is going on in the mind of the husband. And let me tell you, sister, when a husband can take it no longer, he gets up and walks out without a word in most cases.
And of course, the moment he does that and he moves away, right, because he doesn't want to pick a fight with you and doesn't want to do what, he keeps quiet, right, that is what we call the coup de grace. You know, you've heard about coup d'etat that takes place in nations when the president is overthrown or in a particular nation and so forth. You know, it happened that in West Africa recently, right, and we used to have that in this country as well, so you understand a coup d'etat, but here you can have the coup de grace, right? So you find that grace, right, that was existing a few minutes ago, becomes a disgrace in this case. So the man simply walks away and goes away, right? Now the problem in this case that women again do not understand these signals, and that is very terrible. And that's why I'm talking about these things, so that you understand, because I have been counseling men and I know how they feel, and I've been talking to them. And that's the message that comes out, because they don't want to fight you. They don't want to fight their wives, so they simply move away, right? Do not think that when a man walks away in that way, that he doesn't have the energies to fight. He can fight, right? But you understand very well. So in this case, he doesn't want to also scream at the top of his lungs and start saying, "You woman, I don't love you." No, he doesn't want to do that. And he doesn't even want to scream and say, "Maybe you are foolish or you are stupid," right? But I have had women are very good at using such words. A woman will come up and say, "You are foolish, you are very stupid." And then you wonder, you got married to a stupid man, you got married to a foolish man, why did you do that, right? So that's what really happens in most cases. And when men move away, women get shocked and they get stunned. And of course, the women start now interpreting and saying, this man doesn't love me. Because when I speak, he simply keeps quiet. And sometimes the women say, "This man is very stupid, because you talk to him, he doesn't seem to understand the message that you are putting across." Right, so you say it today, you say it tomorrow, you say it another day, every time you are saying the same thing. The husbands have ears, they hear, only that they are using blue hearing aids, and for you are using pink hearing aids, and of course that your tongue is also pink, in other words, sending out those sharp messages, and the men don't want to hear those sharp messages. Many men, if not all men, they do not want to hear those messages, right? And of course, and the men don't want to show the same hostility, right? But I want to tell you that men, in most cases, if they take a decision to marry you and take you in their homes, they love you, right? Only that some of them do not know how to express how much they love you, right? Some of them have never been taught that, you know, you can tell your wife, "I love you, honey, I love you, you are my wife, you are the most beautiful wife on this planet." Some of them, because of the upbringing, right, and the societies and cultures where they're coming from, they do not know how to express that love unto you. And for me, I think in a marriage relationship, right, you learn, because you are not married before, unless you are married before, and you are divorced, now you're in the second marriage or third marriage, whatever it is, or you had a husband who passed on, and then you, right? So most cases, to many people, this is a new experience that you are going through. So there are many, many things that you do not know, and you have to learn along the way. So if in your family, for your sister, you were taught how to love, and you saw how your daddy loved mommy, you can teach your husband in a humble way to love you, and the husband will certainly love you, right? So, but for you just to throw up everything and you start interpreting and saying, "The man doesn't love me and I'm going to divorce you," right? You are making a very big mistake. And after all, Genesis chapter 2, verse 24, which we've just read, it says, Therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Meaning that they are going to super glue onto each other, right? And that's what it is, right? So you need to understand what marriage is all about, and also be careful with the kind of criticism that you make about your husband, right? You degrade your husbands, and your husbands feel very, very, very bad. I know that that happens in your families because of the devil. The devil comes in there and disorganizes you, right? And I know that a husband and wife certainly has goodwill to live together in that holy matrimony, right? The way you made those marriage vows, will you take this one to be your lawful wedded wife or husband and so forth, all those statements that you made, and then you said, I do. And that was our first sermon, if you remember very well. So that's why in most cases, women, the only thing they see and the only thing that they hear is that element of not being loved. And for the husband, the only thing they see and the only thing they hear is disrespect, right? And those two move together, right? In the previous sermon, I told you, and I read you scriptures where women are told to respect, right? And women are also told to love, by the way, if you recall that. And very soon I'll be showing you scriptures that demonstrate that a man is also told to love and respect. Ephesians, you only pick love there, right? But if you continue into other scriptures, you see man is told to also respect the wife. So love and respect is given to both, right? And I will demonstrate to you, last time I demonstrated to you that a woman, right, is told to love, right, and a woman is told to respect, as we saw, right? So men usually go away from women, right, without saying a word, because they do not want to pick up a quarrel, right? They want to distance themselves from those things that will escalate the situation, right? The man wants to behave honorable, right? Honorably, right? And that's why in most cases you will see men, right, being or acting in a honorable way, right? Because that is what is given unto them, right? To behave honorably. Of course, there are some that will fight, and you will see them fighting, right? And I'll be reading you a scripture very soon here, and also give you some bit of experiences of what some people have gone through, right? So there are those people who do not behave in the right way, right? So that's why it is very important for you ladies to really be very careful and stop using those sharp statements or words that can pierce up to the hearts of men, right? So that's why in most cases you need to listen to one another, and that's what I told you last time. In a marriage situation, husband listen, wife listen, right? And you can always talk about those things that bother you in a home, right? Otherwise, if you simply imagine that the man understands, you're going to make a very big mistake. And if you recall last time, I gave you a very good example, and that's how reality is, right? For example, if you walk on a sunny day, right, in front of you, you see a mirage. So for you can be convinced that what you see is water, real, real water, right? But the other person who is very near there, we will tell you, no, there is no water, it's just a mirage. So you can see, you'll be seeing different things, right? Even when, for example, if I pick this Bible here and I show it to you, the person who is very near here can even read some of the words in the Bible here. I can tell you another person there will be able to see, right? And somehow you can guess maybe it's the Bible, right? And but for somebody who is about 600 meters away, he will see this as another book, not necessarily a Bible, right? And that is his interpretation of reality, right? And that's how things are. Reality can be complex, right? Reality can be confusing, and you can pick different interpretations of realities. So never assume that your husband, your wife understands you unless you sit down, right, and you discuss and you talk over these things, right? And that's why it is very, very important. So do not think that he understands you,
right? And that's very important. So the attitude of men that women disrespect, I want to tell you, goes a lot deeper than the fact that they might be immature or proud. So women may actually think that men are immature, that men are proud, right? Because when they speak unto them, they keep quiet. But I want to tell you, the attitude of men will go a lot deeper than the fact that they might be mature the way you think. Men have an honor code, as I've already said. So when a wife comes at a husband who has a basic goodwill and he doesn't want to fight verbally or physically, as his wife rails at him or criticizes, he sits there quietly, which makes her angrier than ever before, because her frontal attack isn't working. She soon sees him as cold and uncaring. Meanwhile, the man is also thinking, I can't believe this, right? Can my wife treat me this way? My wife is treating me with disrespect. In fact, it's really contempt, right? All she can say is that I am unloving. So you will now begin getting onto what I called in the previous sermon, the crazy cycle of love and respect, right? We'll continue and we'll start spinning, right? As it spins and spins and spins, you never know. You might be spinned out of the cycle, right? Meaning that at the end of the day, you get into situations of really parting your ways in a marriage relationship, which is supposed to last forever, right? Till death do we part. And that's why, in most cases, as the woman gets louder, right, he gets quieter, right? Soon she may be screaming at him with the venomous, what you call deadly or lethal words that he has never heard in all his life. And of course, as a rule, women have learned to fight with words, right? And they do that. They are masters of the art. And husbands can feel helpless before the attack, right? And I want to underline that this happens all the time, right? With couples who actually have good intentions, and maybe more so because they feel freely or freer to let down their guard and express what upsets them. So they will say, well, I'm just expressing myself. The husband needs to understand this and this and the other, but you don't know how much you are hurting your husband. You don't know how much you are hurting your wife. And that's why you need to be very careful. Most husbands and wives who are on the crazy cycle that I've just talked about, the love, respect, have basic goodwill, as I've already said, to one another, but they just don't know how to express it in most cases. And that's why in most cases you have those separations, you have those divorces, and so forth. Personally, I have counseled one couple that came into my office, and these were fighting, right? With one another in my office, literally. And that couple came to me before the first lockdown. In fact, I was counseling them before the lockdown, and the lockdown simply stopped everything that was going on, right? And the lady, very highly educated, the husband, very highly educated, they both have very good jobs, right? But of course, they had some misunderstandings here and there, right? But when they came to my office, they were fighting, right, one another, right, in my presence, right? And I had to say, well, please don't, right? And I asked one of them, right, I turned to one of them and I asked the husband, right, does your wife have basic goodwill toward you and others, right? Would you, for example, entrust your husband with the children and assets of the home, right? And the woman said, oh yes, absolutely I would, right? And then I turned to the other lady and said, ma'am, does this husband of yours have basic goodwill, and would you really trust him, right? And the lady said, yes. So when you ask the lady tells you, yes, the husband is okay. And when you ask the husband will tell you, the wife is okay, right? And each one of them will entrust the children and the assets into the hands of the other. So that's what's going on. But then you ask them, what is going on with you two people? What is the problem?
So, and you ask yourself, how can two good-willed people, right, treat one another this way, right? And the husband and the wife will look at me as if to ask, right, what are you really telling us, right? So, all we know is that we fight and fight and fight and fight. Usually we don't know why we are fighting. And that's the biggest problem in our families, in our marriages, we are fighting all the time. But no one ever sat down to start thinking and asking a question, why are we fighting one another? Are we meant to fight one another? No, because Genesis does not say that. Genesis chapter 2 from verse 18, man had a void, right? There was space, there was vacuum that had to be filled, right? And the Bible goes on, and Ephesians chapter 5, women are commanded to respect their husbands, and husbands are told, love your wives, right? And the love that God talks about in Ephesians chapter 5 is sacrificial love, right? Where you do not need to say that there must be conditions attached to it, that you first do this, and then I also do this, right? So it means that even when a lady annoys you, your wife annoys you 1,000 times, right, you don't give up. Try to love her anyhow. I'll be coming to that very soon. So even a wife, you have no excuse. When your husband, right, mistreats you and does so horrible things that you cannot even imagine, race, you are supposed to respect him unconditionally, right? I'll be talking about that very soon. So stop crying, sisters. Stop criticizing, sisters. Stop complaining, sisters, right? So do not send those messages, right? Because those may create more problems and you may end up separating. So do not be harsh. Don't treat one another in a harsh way, right? And that's why I talked about contempt, right? Do not really disrespect your husband, brothers, sisters, right? And for brothers, please love your wives. So, in other words, the sisters, I'm saying, when a husband keeps quiet and does not respond, he's sending a message, right, which is coded, right? That message is in a code, right, in codes, is coded, right, and you need to encode it. The husband is telling you, I need respect, I want your respect, right, and you must really decode that message. Right, and decode it in the right way, because if a man simply keeps quiet the first day, the second time he keeps quiet, you never know, later on that man may keep quiet forever, right? And when he keeps quiet forever, you'll have a problem, right, in your home. And that is more or less a separation, right? So those problems will come, and that's why you need to really stand with your spouse, right, in all these days, in all those difficult times, so that you are able to move. I know that men are very good at stonewalling, right? Men are very good at avoiding. Men are very good at evading their wives, especially when their wives become so hostile, right? I know they are very good at that, right? And when they are confronted by their wives, they stonewall. And men and women are so fed up with the husbands who don't seem to want to love them, because they misinterpret that to actually mean that they are not loved, right? And and for men, the last thing they want to see is disrespect, right? So the women will say, right, and these are the things that I've heard women say, well, the husband has to earn, right, that respect, right? The husband has to earn my respect. It's not given out freely, right? And some husbands say, well, she has to earn that love. I don't give it out freely, right? And let me tell you, if you don't give out that love, she will disrespect you. And if you don't respect, he will not love you, right? That love will be withheld, and you have that cycle spinning and continuing to spin and spin and spin and spin and spin and spin, right? So, but you need to know that you have to decipher, right, your spouse's code, and of course that will not be done in one day, it can't be done in 1 month, it can't be done in about 2 months. So as you live together, right, in marriage, you start learning, and I think A wise woman and a wise husband will spend that marriage time trying to learn the other spouse. And I can assure you, with the time, you'll be able to understand your husband, and you'll be able to understand your wife. And in situations where you do not know what is going on, ask, right? Ask what she means, and she will tell you, and you can also ask him what he means, right? I'll tell you, one day I was confronted with what I call a counseling situation, right? And of course, the lady, right, made a statement, and the husband made a statement. But let me just give you a statement that was made by the lady, right? By the husband. The husband came to me, right? And as we were talking through counseling, of course, not really meeting both of them at the same time, right? The husband, after talking to the husband, he said, "Thanks for all your suggestions and support, right? But I remain perplexed at the gap or chasm that exists between me and my wife, right? That exists between my perception, right, of my wife and the reality of what is going on." And he said, when I began this endeavor of coming to you, I really had hope, right? And I knew that we were going to discuss, and I would be able to get solutions, quick solutions that would be able to fix my problem, right? And also get the expectations. And I was really very happy to see how quick and positive of your ideas of loving, right? When you told me that I should really love my wife, right? I really saw loving behavior and what loving behavior really means, right? But it was not difficult to bite my tongue and not fight back when I prepared myself for it. I think that while I felt apologetic, I can easily be humble and pretty much take anything that comes my way. The difficulty begins when I begin to see things return to normal. When I let my guard down, I begin to talk or share, and it turns out that underneath things are very volatile and very sensitive. When things started to go bad last week, it happened extremely fast, and I was surprised to hear how all the same issues remain at the same raw and grim level. I hate hearing that I am her enemy. It is painful to hear her ask, "Why do you want to crush my spirit?" It is extremely difficult to not explode in despair when I hear her say that she doesn't believe that I love her, or that I will never change, or that she made a mistake and I'm not the man she thought I was, and that she shouldn't have gotten married to me. Right, I really feel very bad. It makes me seem that the road is long and possibly fruitless. I mean, it's getting angry and blaming her, and the gambit of emotional upheavals. I really have these problems every now and then. So I'm just giving you the experience of somebody who came to me and had that kind of problem, right? As he was trying to solve these problems, the woman continued, right? Because, you know, I told him, go and love her anyhow, show her love. But the more he tried to do certain things, the more the lady became very annoyed. And the lady would say, "I don't even know how I got married to you. You were a wrong man to begin with." So, and the man continued to get angry. So what I'm telling you here is that, yes, from what I've just told you, you see, right, how things can actually spin out, right? And that's why it takes two people. It takes a man and a woman to work on your marriage, right? If you think that one person, right, like you say, husband's love, right? You know, you can hammer that aspect of love. Say, love your wives, love your wives, love your wives, love your wives, right? Now, if a lady does not reciprocate by loving, I can assure you, you'll have a problem. But the Bible is very clear. It tells a man to love in Ephesians, Right? But it also tells in Titus chapter 2, the scripture tells old women to teach young women to love their husbands and also love their children. And that is what verse 4 says, right? So we need to be very, 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 very careful, right? Titus is very clear about that. That is chapter 2, verse 4, right, brothers and sisters. So we need to know these things and be able to move on and move on and move on. So, and I can tell you very few men can articulate the kinds of situation they are going through. I know men are very good at keeping quiet, right, in most cases. Even when they are in terrible situations, they keep quiet. I know the women are very quick. They'll move around, tell the neighbors how bad a man is. They'll move around and tell the men they find on the street and the women on the street. They'll go, when they go for their hairdressing, they tell all the women in the saloons how bad the husband is, that kind of thing. But men usually keep quiet. They do not even want to share it with their fellow men because of that honor, right, that they have. And that's what women ought to know in this case. So do not abuse your husbands, right? Do not abuse each other, right? So I'll tell you this, women need love. Husbands need respect. These are primary needs, right? The husband and for the wife. However, the Bible also requires a reciprocal relationship. A husband will need love and respect, just like a wife will need love and respect too. Now, when I usually talk to women and I tell them that you must provide unconditional respect, women think that these two words cannot come together. You can't add unconditional and you can't bring it to that word called respect, right? Because respect is respect. How can you say unconditional respect? So when you say, and they see it as an oxymoron, right? The two words, right? A combination of contradictory or what we call incongruous words, right? They are not congruent. So when I talk to wives, right, that they and I talk about unconditional love, right, they don't have any problem understanding it because they expect men to provide unconditional love. But you tell women unconditional respect, you have a problem. So very few women seem to see 1 Peter, right, and I want us to read 1 Peter, right, together. If you can open your Bibles, 1 Peter chapter 3, right, and then we read verse 1 and verse 2, right. I hope you are very near your Bibles, right, and you have opened that very section where you have 1 Peter, right. And I'll tell you, 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 1 and 2 says, likewise, ye wives, be in subjection to your own husbands, right? That if any obey not the word, they also may, without the word, be won by the conversation of their wives. Be won by the conversation of their wives, right? While they behold your chaste conversations coupled with fear. Now, when you look at the scripture, the Apostle Peter reveals that husbands who are disobedient to the word, you can actually call these unbelieving, right, husbands, right? Meaning that maybe they do not even deserve respect in this case, right? But these unbelieving husbands, they need to be respected, right? Because they may be won by respectful behavior. That's why the Bible tells us, we have just read, likewise, ye wives, right, be in subjection to your own husbands. Being in subjection means obedience. means respect, right? That if, for example, you have an unbelieving husband, if any obey not the word, means that he is an unbeliever, really, in this case, right? They also may, without the word, without you preaching the word unto that person, be won by the conversation of the wives only. So your behavior, your conversation, without even picking a Bible and reading a scripture and telling your husband that, you know, God said this and this and the other, your respectful behavior will win this husband unto Christ, brothers and sisters. And that's what the Bible tells you. Right? Your behavior preaches, right, much more than you picking the Bible and telling somebody to behave, right? Your actions, right, your behavior can bring somebody closer to Christ, but your behavior and actions can push this man far away from the word. And that's why you wives have pushed your husbands far away from the word. And you go around and complain and say, he wasn't a believer to begin with. You know, if he can do this, he was never saved. Who tells you? Right. I'll tell you, there, and as I said last time, there are many, many men, even in the Bible, who made mistakes. I gave an example of David, right, who made a mistake. But God was in it, incidentally. Right. Take an example of Samson. Samson made a mistake. Right, God was in it, right? So do not begin now using those sharp pointed pink words and say, my husband has never believed in Christ, and that's why he went back to the world, right? And you even begin quoting scriptures very, very fast the way we do, right? Because they went out of us, because they were not one of us. I know that's a scripture, but you are even misquoting, mislocating, and misapplying the scriptures because you have failed to meet your responsibility as a wife. So 1 Peter chapter 3 tells you to be in subjection to your own husbands, that if any obey not the word, they may, without the word, be won by the conversation of the wives while they behold, right, your chest conversation, your chest conversation. You see, chest, it has, that conversation has no guile. That conversation that is very powerful, right, that will bring honor unto the man. I told you, a man wants to be honored. When he keeps quiet and does not fight back and goes away, he's looking for honor, right? And you ought to know that very well. Chest conversation coupled with fear. So even when you are talking about your husband, you must be fearful. It's like me talking about Christ, because when God types a family with a husband and wife, he again lets it to Christ and the church. When I start talking about Christ today, right, I talk with fear, right? My conversation, right, must be chaste. I must be having chaste conversation coupled with fear, right, when I'm talking about Christ. But today you find women talking about their husbands and saying terrible things and terrible words. So that's why even those who do not obey the word can be brought unto obedience, right, through your conversation, right, as we say. And as you can see, a simple understanding of the scripture is that a wife is to display a respectful facial expression and tone. So do not shout at your husband, right? Even when you are looking at him, do not put on that gloomy face. When the husband fails to be the man that you want him to be, you tolerate your husband, right? So, in other words, give your husband unconditional respect in tone and expression. Right? Do not say that you have to earn respect. Right? Don't say you have to earn love. No. So, when you are confronting his unloving behavior, sisters, right, you do not have to endorse those unloving conditions and reactions. Because if he does express and use those words that are sharp, then the husband will be pushed back and back and back and back and back. Because behavior breeds behavior in most cases. And that's how most people react. I'm not saying that this man should not be filled with the Holy Ghost. No. A man that is filled with the Holy Ghost will behave. And a woman. But you know, Satan will tempt you. And that's why I read you the scripture last time. 1 Corinthians chapter 7. That you need to be wise. Right. The Bible says. And 1 Corinthians. Right. When Paul was speaking and writing unto them, he says, it's good for a man, right, not to touch a wife, but nonetheless to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife, and let a wife have his her own husband. And then he went on and spoke all those things, and then he talked about defrauding ye not one another. Do not defraud ye one another. Right. So, of course, he's telling you that it would have been good for you to be single, right, but because of a number of circumstances and situations, right. But of course, the Bible, Paul continues to say, right, within a period, you can give yourself to prayer and fasting, but after that, come back together again so that Satan does not tempt you. Satan will tempt you, certainly, brothers and sisters. Let me just give you an example here of a story. Again, to demonstrate, I'm not saying you should not be filled with the Holy Ghost, I'm saying that, but even then, when you are filled with the Holy Ghost, right, the spirit of the prophet is subject unto the prophet. So meaning that even when you are filled, you know, you need to act with restraint. You learn to behave when the Holy Ghost, when you are filled with the Holy Ghost, when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. And you know what happens that day when they were up in the upper chamber, when the Holy Ghost fell. Right, these people did not become more terrible than what they were. No, you find those who were murderers, they suddenly stopped what they were doing. When they met God himself along the way, you know the story of Saul, you know the story of Paul. Right, when he met God, the situation became different. He did not become hostile. But you wonder in marriages, two people coming together from different backgrounds, right, coming to form a family, but they are busy fighting one another. It's terrible. Let me give you an example that the prophet gives, right? An example of a drunkard, right? This was a husband, right, who used to enjoy booze quite often. And for you who have met that message, you'll find that in the message, right, that that is called Questions and Answers number 3. Which was delivered on Sunday morning, 30th August 1964. Right, and you know that very well, right. So, in that message, right, we are told that one time there was a little woman, right, who had received the Holy Ghost. So this woman was full of the Holy Ghost, right, and I want you to take this example of this woman. She was a very sweet little person. Well, but she was going through a very hard time, right? At home, her husband was an alcoholic. So the husband enjoyed booze very much. He enjoyed alcohol very much, right? He enjoyed wine very much, enjoyed beer very much. Now, her husband was an alcoholic, as you can see. But this lady, right, became patient and kept on hanging on and on and on and on and on, right? Now, to the husband thought that this woman is boring. She's a bore to him. I mean, those are the statements you usually express. She's boring because the lady would think about going to church and praying and so forth, but the man enjoyed booze. They lived lives which are totally the opposite to each other. But she kept hanging on in this kind of relationship. And even you, brothers and sisters, where you are, you are not even in this kind of relationship that we are talking about here that I'm describing. The kind of marriage is not similar to this, where a husband is an alcoholic and a woman is filled with the Holy Ghost, right? But for you, you go to church, right? You go to the same church and you pray and you listen to the same preachers, but there must be something wrong with you. Right, because when you go back, you fight each other and you tear each other into pieces. Right. So she kept on. Now, to the husband, she was a boa. The husband would say, well, you want to go to church, honey? Take off. Right? But and the man would say, but for me, I'll just go down to the saloon, down at the Old Brown Derby, down there. So he used to have a group. I used to have colleagues. So they hang out down there at Boniface all the time. Right. That place, as the prophet says, called Brown Derby now, I believe it is. So they would go and hang into that place. But he would tell the woman, you want to go to church? Take off. Right, you can imagine that kind of language. Right. And the first thing you know, one night as they were seated having a round of booze, right, and as they were enjoying one night, a question came up. Right, and they started discussing about church and about Christians and Christianity. So one of the members in that club of the fellows who enjoyed boozing a lot posed a question, and he said, right, of course he said, there isn't such a thing as Christianity anymore. Do we still have Christians anyway? Do they still exist? We don't seem to have any one of them. There isn't such a thing as Christianity, right? There is no such a thing. All these are a bunch of hypocrites. They are actors. So they go to church, right? And of course, all that we see all of them doing is to also behave the way we do, although they do that in hiding. So they also smoke or they drink. So they do the same thing that we do, and those fellows call themselves Christians. They are not Christians. So, one of them said, there is no such a thing, Christianity is not there. Now, this young man, who had a wife that is filled with the Holy Ghost, right, stood up, he raised up on his feet and he said, just a minute. There is one Christian that I know about. And then these other members of the club asked, who is that? That's right, they asked, who is that? Who is it? Because we know we no longer have Christians, true Christians anymore. Those fellows are not in any way different from us. So the man said, it's my wife. You see, my wife I know is a Christian. She's a Christian. Another one said, I bet if she was put to a squeeze, a real test, I bet whether that woman would be a Christian. She wouldn't remain a Christian anymore. Now this man defended, he said, no, sir. She's still a Christian. I'll prove it to you, he said. I'll tell you what, let's do it. Let's go and tempt her and squeeze her and try her. You'll see she'll come out a Christian. Let's go up home now and I'll show you whether she's a Christian or not. I have seen her, although for me, I enjoy my booze. I know my wife is a Christian. They all said, no way. Okay, let's go. They all agreed to go home and test this woman. Let's go up. And first of all, they first rehearsed a few things that, you know, when we are going there, we are going to pretend that we are really soaked up in booze. Right, that we don't even understand what is happening all around. And we are going to try her. Right. And it tested her thoroughly. So they all agreed and off they went. So when they reached home, they knocked at the door. Knocked. So they were all staggering all over the place. They were staggering all over the place. And they knocked and knocked and knocked and knocked. The wife heard. And she came at the door and opened for them and set up all of them in the chairs, right? And tried to make them as welcome as they could be and make them as comfortable as they could be. Now the husband demanded and said, I want you to fix up some supper. And so she went out and fixed some and brought the supper. Right. When she brought it, said, now this one doesn't look nice. Kicked it all over. Said, now I want you to go and fix for me ham and eggs and bring them right now. So she went and fixed ham and eggs. When the husband got there at the table, he looked at the fellow drunkards. The lady had already fixed the eggs and she looked at the egg. He looked at the eggs, picked up the plate and slammed the stuff on the floor and said, you know, I don't like my eggs like that. Come on, boys, let's get out here anyhow, like that. So he became very, very, very annoyed. Remember, they were acting out something. And they wanted to prove that this lady was actually a Christian. So they went out and sat down like that, you know. And she came out. She said, dear honey, I'm so sorry I didn't get them fixed. I'll fix some more for you. The man said, oh, nonsense. You knew I didn't want them that way. In the first place, just carrying on like that. They went out and sat down and act like they were terribly drunk. They had her in the background. They are snubbing to herself, singing real low voice. Must Jesus bear the cross alone? Oh, the world go free. There's a cross for everyone, and there's a cross for me. This consecrated cross I'll bear till death shall set me free. One drunk fellow looked at the other drunk fellow, and he said, she's really Christian. She has got the Holy Ghost. And that little woman led her husband plus these others to Christ that night. You see what we are talking about? The lady remained sweet. Right. Very, very sweet. Just remember, he knows all about it. So sister, brothers, wherever you are, right? And let me tell you the reason why. And you know, Christ will create a situation. God will create a situation or a condition that you will be led to Christ. Remember, as they were seated boozing. Right? You see, this woman did not disrespect. This woman never disrespected the man because the man used to enjoy booze. No! The conversation of the woman, the behaviors and the actions of the woman led this husband to really believe that she's really born again and filled with the Holy Spirit. And that's why when they're conversing and they say, we no longer have Christians, right? And you don't even know where the conversation came from. God was in that conversation. And then this man said, I know, right? I know there is a Christian. We still have Christians, real genuine Christians, and my wife is one of them. So they go home to tempt her. She never went out of her state. Right. She only sang, must Jesus suffer? Right. And that's what it was. If there's anything in her to thirst for, it was Christ. So that's why you need to be very careful. Do not say, I got a wrong person. Who tells you? God wanted to mold out a character and behavior out of you. You just keep on going, going and going. All wrongs will be made right there as you are moving on. And that's why the Bible says in Matthew chapter 5, right? For many of you who are Bible readers, Matthew chapter 5, verse 13, and we can read that scripture. It says, you are the salt of the earth, right? But if the salt have lost its savor, Wherewith shall it be salted? It is thenceforth good for nothing, but to be cast out and to be trodden under foot of men. That is Matthew 5:13. Right, and 14 says, ye are the light of the world. A city that is set on a hill cannot be hid. Right. And verse 15, neither do men light a candle and put it under a bushel, but on a candlestick, and it giveth light unto all in the house. Let your light therefore shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father which is in heaven. So, brothers and sisters, as I was saying, sisters, respect your husbands. Give them unconditional respect, just like the sister did, right, unto the husband, who was a drunkard, who used to enjoy booze and alcohol, and she was able to bring him to Christ, him without the word, by her chest conversation, right, the husband was brought unto Christ. Right, so do not say that my husband, because my husband has done something bad, he deserves contempt. Right, that doesn't win him any more than harshness and anger wins the heart of a woman. So, interestingly, in this situation, if the woman had become hostile, they would have gone away very happy, having proven their case that there is no Christian in this world, that this lady was not really a Christian and filled with the Holy Ghost. But instead, they were brought to Christ. This lady won her. This lady won them to Christ. So, as you can see, interestingly, at first, many don't grasp the idea of unconditional right respect either. And I will take you through that very soon, that even men need to respect their wives. Right. So, I'll come to that, but we are mainly talking about those aspects. I want to really come to a close, but I want to talk about a small thing related to respect, right? The husband wants to earn respect, but he doesn't feel he deserves the kind of disrespect he's getting from his wife. The Bible teaches unconditional respect. Show proper respect to everyone. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 17, right? Up to 18 says that. Right. So that's why I've told you this respect is unconditional, right? As I told you repeatedly, I hear comments like these from wives. How can I show respect for him when he comes across as so unloving? He doesn't deserve respect. He has hurt me. Right. Sometimes women may say, I love him, but I get so frustrated and angry, I don't want to respect him. Right. And to them, they are telling you it is love that matters. And they tell you, if he loved me as I need to be loved, maybe I would have stronger feelings of respect. That's why most women even say, that let me wait for him in the third room. I'll show him. If he does not love me, does not give me money, let's wait. I'm going to wait. I'm going to put up an embargo in the bedroom. He will see. Right? And the more you put up that embargo in the bedroom, the more you worsen things. As if you have never read 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and as if you have never had an aunt, a singer, to guide you. And you make the whole thing worse. So, as you try to solve this problem of love, right, then the man will run away and go into infidelity. You find him running around with the other women. And then you start saying, hey, anyway, he wasn't a Christian to begin with. That he doesn't understand. You are leading him into temptation. That's why you pray every day the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, Hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is well. Lead us not into temptation. And that's what you always pray. But you don't even understand what that means. You leave others into temptation. Right, and then you say, well, I have many other things to deal with. Now, the truth is that he needs love. Right? And the truth is that he needs to love, as Ephesians 5 says, and respect, right? All of that is very important, and we need to love one another, and we need to respect one another, right? So, I think I'll really stop here, right? And then when we meet again in our next service, then we shall start from there, right? So I think you can see we are talking about love, right? And we are still talking about love. We are talking about love, and we are talking about respect, right? And for some of you who attended our last service, right, we talked about that love-respect, right, cycle that we called really the crazy cycle, right? So you need to understand why she wants respect and why he wants love, right? And then work out that prayerfully all the time. And that's why you must reserve time as husband and wife to pray. And that's why even 1 Corinthians chapter 7 tells you, right, that you know you need that time to pray, right? And even after prayer, make sure that you come back together again. So you must be very close. So I'll be talking about that later on. I don't want to introduce it now, right? 1 Corinthians 7 is another chapter that we shall be dealing with, right? So as we can see, our topic today was about contempt and hostility in marriage, right? And contempt certainly is related to respect, and then hostility certainly is related to love, as you can see. We read Genesis chapter 2, verse 18. We went to Ephesians chapter 5, verse 22 to 28. And the brothers and sisters, we need to be mindful of that. And I want you to join me as we pray and bring this service to a close. I want you to join me, and I want us to pray prayerfully. Join me in prayer. Dear God, I want to thank you and glorify thy name. For Father, we know you are the same yesterday, today, and forever. Father, we can talk about these things, but a revelation comes from thee, and a real, genuine spirit, Father, getting hold of thy son and thy daughter, wherever they are, and transforming their lives, Lord, to live a life that is totally different from what others are living in this world. That man and that woman that is changed completely, as we saw that very example of a lady, Father, where the husband and other men were having that time and drinking, and they started a conversation saying, there is nobody that you can call a real genuine Christian. But this man testified for this woman, and this woman never let this man down when they went out to test her. Father, as they tried her patience, as they tried her anger, as they tried her disobedience, as they tried her love, the more they tried her, the more she demonstrated that Christ had taken a hold of her heart and God was reigning in her body. Father, we see this woman bring the husband unto Christ and bringing the other men unto Christ as well. Father, as we have heard that night, this group came to Christ. I want to thank you, and I'm praying for thy children who are gathered here in the congregation, Lord. Give them a mixed spirit. Father, guide them. Go with them wherever they go. May that pillar of fire that led the children of Israel at night, and that pillar of cloud that went with the children of Israel during the day, go with thy congregation. Go with thy sons and thy daughters. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we prayed. Amen and amen. May God richly bless you. We thank God, and I want to invite you for our next service. God bless you. Have a nice time. Bye.